Attendees are in listen-only mode.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming here today. Welcome to today's Sustainable Seminar Center. For those in attendance here, we want to welcome you, and for those listening online. My name is Nancy Holm. As most of you know, I'm the Assistant Director here at the Illinois Sustainable Technology Center and the seminar series organizer. Today's talk is part of our series for this fall, which we've entitled Sustainability in Action, Technology in Practice. All of the seminars are broadcast live and also archived on our website. We've had some delay in putting up the past two seminars, but we hope to get those posted next week. So today we're very pleased to have with us via the internet Mr. Jeff Mendez presenting a webinar for us from Toronto, Canada. Jeff is the Global Communications Director for Electronic Recycling Services, ERS International. ERS was founded in 2003 and now has locations in 11 places worldwide. Jeff is going to discuss today ways new technologies can help in recycling electronics, as well as innovative methods of upcycling, which can help reuse many of the so-called e-waste and be able to produce valuable products. I would ask that everyone hold their questions until the end of the seminar. And then for those here, to please come up and use this microphone we have here so we can record your voice and everyone can hear. And then for those who are watching online, we'll ask that you type in your questions. We've got all microphones muted, so if you could type in your questions, we will read those at the end and answer all of the questions. So with that, I'd like to turn over the seminar. We'll switch to Jeff, who will be discussing recycling and upcycling of electronics waste. Jeff?
Thank you very much, Nancy, and hello, everyone. Good afternoon. We're going to be talking about a few things here. First and foremost, when I present this presentation, I use a very dynamic and nonlinear form of presenting via software called Prezi. There may be a little lag due to the internet, but we're going to go ahead and get started right away. So first and foremost, it's great to be here. The content of this presentation is going to be broken down to a few things. First and foremost, innovation and technology. This talks about our processing lines and exactly what happens to e-waste and how it's actually processed, so you guys have a good understanding of that. Secondly, we're going to talk about security. Security is paramount when it comes to e-waste because you're talking about a lot of data and you have to make sure that that's dealt with properly. Now, of course, we're left with a lot of post materials, hence the third topic and the most focused topic will be our research and development, recycling and upcycling solutions. And I'll be sure to break down the difference of everything as we move along. So let's talk about ERS International first and foremost. A company that was based out of Toronto has grown exponentially. And the reason for that is the need to recycle electronics everywhere. Every country we're in has their own legislations as to how to process these electronics because a lot of people still don't realize there are many, many hazardous materials within this e-waste, cadmium, mercury, lead, you name it. So it does need to be treated properly to make sure it does not go into our soils and our drinking water. So the within 10 years, we've grown exponentially with 11 locations, soon to be 12, expanding in Asia. So, I mean, over 800 employees worldwide, four continents, six countries, over 650,000 square feet of facilities, we're able to do that. Now, the reason why I like to show that we're HQ'd out of Toronto is, from an American perspective, and I've worked throughout the U.S. For many, many years, we find that Toronto internationally is recognized for their green initiatives. I almost like to make it comparable to us being the California of the U.S., if you will. It was very pro-green and with lots of programs, initiatives that seems to start or initiate on that West Coast and thoroughly roll out throughout the rest of America. So everything we do is pretty much modeled throughout the entire world when it comes to our global network. So let's talk about the advantages. We're invested in multi-million dollar processing lines. These are the first of its kind that people will see in North America and now South America. We process 98% of virtually all electronics coming in, but if you entail our upcycling processes, we're talking 99.99% of all common e-waste is processed. The only reason why we can say 100% is we can't account for the dust. That's my little joke. Not yet anyway. Zero incineration, zero exportation, zero landfill. And of course, here's the kicker. the reuse of mixed plastics and glass. This is what I talk about post materials. These are the materials that are usually landfilled, incinerated, because nobody else knows what to do with it until now. So let's talk about the process so you guys get a good idea of what happens behind closed doors once your e-waste is sent. So the right thing to do is to bring your e-waste to the right collection points. We work with all sorts of waste management companies, so we'll get it in through our doors one way or another. If it's not our fleet of trucks want to pick it up, it'll be fleets of trucks dropping off with our partnerships. What you're going to see is this. As soon as e-waste comes in, besides the data wiping that's taking place, besides the categorizing and weighing of everything coming in, we start with dismantling. So e-waste comes in, and this is quite educational. As it comes in, everything is taken apart manually. Why? Because it's the most efficient way to do things. So what we'll start doing when it comes to refining and processing, we'll have the chassis of the computers with the chassis, the heat cores with the heat cores, the fans with the fans, the motherboard with the motherboard. This allows for quicker processing for cleaner refinement at the end of the day. So once that's done, we start shredding. This is what happens to e-waste. As you can see, in this case, it's motherboards. We start shredding everything, and shredding is done at a mass capacity. These are large, large lines and can handle the volume. Now, once shredding is done, it goes through sorting. So it goes up the next conveyor belt, and the reason why you see people up there standing is sorting. What's done here is we take virgin material. At the top of the screen, you'll see a gentleman holding metal. So anything that's virgin on its own, such as metal on its own or plastic on its own, will be segregated down these chutes and will continue to be processed that way. Again, we're trying to get the cleanest refining and the quickest and cleanest and most efficient way of processing. And the best way to do that is to have materials isolated. So the name of the game now becomes impact separation. From the beginning of the destruction of e-waste, the name of the game is to constantly size reduce, smaller and smaller. And that's what's happening throughout this whole process, including large magnets to separate magnetic metals versus non-magnetic metals, for example, your copper versus aluminum, etc. Once things get segregated and size reduced, it goes into granulation. So there is your e-waste. What used to be your phone, what used to be your laptop, what used to be your computer has now completely been destroyed. For number one, this is good for security purposes, knowing that there's no possible data recovery. And number two, we've refined to the point where all the materials have been segregated, including the hazardous materials versus non-hazardous materials. And at the end of the day, this is it. Electrostatic separation. So why is this important? Here's another piece of education that some of you may know, but some of you may not. It's no secret that the most stable metals and electronics are actually precious metals. So this is what drives larger corporations who have an obscene amount of e-waste to start a program with us, and we can start all sorts of programs with you. One of them, the potential of revenue sharing. Because we have the power of electrostatic separation, here's proof of what your e-waste is to be. At the end of the day, we're able to segregate metals from non-metals. What does that mean? Well, your non-metals would be your plastics, as in the casing of your cables or the plastic of the chassis or the plastic in the back of your cell phone, versus metals. And remember, I said some of the most stable metals in electronics are precious metals, hence your gold, your aluminum, your copper, your titanium. And if we can segregate that, then we actually have a business model that not only can help programs with all our partner companies, but obviously give something back. So this is the whole point of line, is to not only utterly destroy, to segregate hazardous materials from non-hazardous materials, and the potential of revenue sharing for our clients, which is a big motivational factor. Now keep in mind that the amount of commodities in a laptop is minimal, minimal, minimal. It will take quite a bit of volume in order to start getting some recovery. But at the end of the day, sometimes it can pay for the freight in itself. And again, it motivates corporations all over the world to start joining into a green program. So that pretty much covers the actual processing lines. Remember, it starts from manual dismantling all the way to complete and utter destruction through a powder form of electrostatic separation. Next is security. Security is a very important feature of e-waste as well, and you can imagine why. We deal with hospitals, we deal with governments, we deal with all sorts of companies, with financials, that if the security is not there, there's a breach. So therefore, we had to have the most stringent security protocol in place. And a lot of people don't realize how secure it is when it comes to recycling. We institute a three-tier security model. We have a restricted access security vault with 20-inch steel doors with its own independent shredder. Usually that's used for very classified information, government information, sometimes even a product protocol or recall that cannot see the light of the processing floor. It'll be destroyed, segregated in its own vault. 24/7 around-the-clock security patrol in every recycling facility, single security key pass access, and close circuit cameras with data retention to make sure that everything's is recalled. So this is what it takes to recycle. I mean, security is a very, very large component when it comes to recycling to assure that protocols are being put. Here's a quick example of our secure vault. You can actually see it in the back to the left where it says restricted access. It has its own bay, but it almost has like the airport scanners and the wanders. Security is taken very, very seriously when it comes to e-waste. And this is, I wanted to show this to kind of emphasize how important recyclers take security, especially when it comes to processing data. So security goes far beyond our e-waste. We actually use the same protocol for our staff as well. Believe it or not, this is me, and I'm not sure if you guys can see me from that end, but you can tell it was a while back. I was about 20 pounds lighter back then. But anyhow, I had to go through this for about 3 months. I literally could not come in with a cell phone, so I was wandered in and out until I passed my probationary period and was able to finally have not be confined to just a landline. But again, this is something we take very seriously, and a large, large component of e-waste is security. So moving along now, the question always comes, why so secure? Well, clearly, in order for us to adhere, maintain our high-profile local, national, and global clients, we had to assure we follow their strict security adherences for data, for equipment, and for personnel. So all we're doing is paralleling a no-risk environment. And this all comes intact when you will see this in all sorts of components with any large client you have. They will have a protocol that they themselves need to adhere to, and we just want to match that to make a parallel environment to make sure that everything is correct and we can keep doing the green thing, the right thing. Moving along, we'll talk about audit process certifications. I'm not sure if this is pertinent to you guys at all, but there are a lot of certifications involved when it comes to being a certified recycler and or processor. Dealing with the MOE, the Ministry of the Environment, the EPA, and these are audit process certifications. That being said, you don't just kind of go through the prerequisites and you get a certificate. You're constantly audited. People will show up at our facility every time unannounced to assure that there's full transparency and they can see that things are being properly treated, because remember, we're dealing with a lot of hazardous materials that can be very harmful to the environment and essentially to our lives. So we have pretty much every possible certification under the belt, and we continue to be audited and have not had an incident since. So now we talk about our research and development. We covered the processing, the lines, and it's a fully mechanized automated processing line. We've talked about security, how important that is. Now we're going to talk about a little research and development. This is where things get a little more exciting, at least for me it does anyhow. And what we have here is a state-of-the-art within our facility. We have a state-of-the-art research and development scientific laboratory. This is where technology and solutions for difficult to recycle products are found. And we also do upcycling here. And upcycling capabilities are actually done through testing and product output. We are making things. And I'll break it down to you. But first we should talk about upcycling. Upcycling is a rather new term. I do tours and presentations throughout the globe, and you'd be surprised at how many people still don't recognize upcycling. In fact, if I type up upcycling in my Word document, it'll try to auto-correct me. So it's still relatively new. But what is upcycling? We have recycling, and we have upcycling. In layman's terms, to recycle is to reuse. So the way I like to explain it is like a glass Coca-Cola bottle. If I had a glass Coca-Cola bottle, I can reuse it. I can resanitize it, I can rebrand it, I can refill it, I can recap it, and I can put it on the market again. So I'm reusing that, I'm recycling it. But when that glass bottle breaks, I can't do any of those things anymore. So that glass, broken glass, becomes waste materials. So that's your recycling, to reuse until you can't anymore. To upcycle would be to gather what otherwise would have been waste materials, re-engineer them into a brand new innovative product, and reintroducing that product back into the economic cycle of life. So to recycle is to reuse, to upcycle is to redo. And that's kind of the way I like to explain it, where people kind of understand it a little better. I'm going to skip this slide because that pretty much, I did the spiel there, so you guys won't have to see that. But let me kind of bring you into our laboratory so you can see how things work at a recycling facility. So this is the floor. This is somewhat of a sanitized area, so not everybody has access. We do have a residential PhD and research chemist who work on site. But we also do work with a team of PhDs around the world, including Professor Dr. Jacqueline James, who's from University of Miami, and she's spearheading one of our very, very important upcycling products, which I'll get into a little further on. But let's actually walk into the lab, and this is what it looks like. So we do have a full-blown lab, but more importantly is the equipment we use. And one of those pieces of equipment, which you're about to see here on the right-hand side, is what we call the XRF. It's the X-ray, I've got to go to my notes here, X-ray fluorescence spectroscopy, which is a a really big x-ray. Why do we need it? Well, we pulverize everything. Everything we do is pulverized for a reason. In this middle slide right now, you see the blue gloves. Things are kind of pelletized. They're like little caplets and pellets. Everything we do, we will granulate to a sand form, if you will. And then what we do is we run that through our x-ray machine to assure that we have a full comprehensive report of what is made up in these materials. There's a lot of new technology out there, and when we get certain technologies that we don't understand, we need to assure we know what's inside. Twofold. Number one, hazardous materials. And number two, if there's any possible recovery that we can help the client with. And that's the reason for that. So it's very important that we're all constantly checking and doing elemental analysis of everything that comes in, because we need to know what materials we're dealing with. This XRF itself out of Switzerland, we were the first one in the country to get it, and it has the same technology as the Land Rover from Mars. So it's not bad, but I'll tell you what's better is our new X-ray machine, and this one is called, forgive me, I got to read my notes here, inductively coupled plasma mass spectroscopy. I'll repeat that. We use the ICPMS, inductively coupled plasma mass spectroscopy. Why is this important? Well, number one, it can do organic materials as well, not just solids. We can do liquids as well, acid, if you will. So we can actually do an elemental analysis, not at the parts per million, not at the parts per billion, but at the parts per trillion. This is very, very important and very exciting news that we can get so deep into knowing what type of materials we're dealing with, because this also helps us with the upcycling. So again, a full-fledged lab, a team of PhDs, and a state-of-the-art equipment that allows us to do things. Now, let's talk about plastic. We talked about earlier in that earlier slide, you might have remembered that I mentioned the reuse of mixed plastics, key word here, mixed plastics and glass. E-waste has an abundance of plastic. I mean, you look at any piece of electronic equipment, it's wrapped in plastic. If not on the outside, on the inside, if not both. So there's a lot of plastic we deal with. Why is this important? Well, think back about the processing line. Things are thrown into the shredder. Things are constantly being size reduced into a powder. When you're looking at that powder, you're looking at a lot of mixed plastic. Low density, high density, polycarbonate, plexi, you name it. There's tons of plastics, different types, different densities. So what do people do with that plastic? Well, you can't do much. Some people will landfill because they have no choice. Other people will say that they don't landfill. It's true, they don't. They incinerate. And incinerating is not landfilling, but let's not forget about the emissions and the toxins going into our air. So we decided to take it one step further, and we started playing with some fusing technology, and we said, hey, we're going to try to kind of mold and melt this plastic all together. Seems easy, doesn't it? It's not. Remember, different types of plastics have different density. If I have plastic A, plastic B, and plastic C, by the time I reach the thermal point for plastic A and I'm able to bend and mold, well, guess what? Plastic B has already melted or burnt, and plastic C is still brittle. So you could imagine it is very difficult. Now, one thing that we do, not only do we have a team of PhDs, we also have a team of engineers, and we actually manufacture our own machinery. Why is that important? It allows us to have technology in creating what we call a plastic extrusion machine. Not only do we process manufacture our processing lines, we've actually got the technology to manufacture our own extrusion line. So what we do is we found that magical combination to be able to fuse this mixed plastic together, and we're creating lumber planks. And that's what we're doing. It takes a lot of plastic. Remember, it's like at the end of the process, and you have a sand-like product. So you can imagine how much of that sand is necessary to densify into one of these pieces of wood. It weighs about 18 pounds, and that piece alone can hold over 600 pounds of weight. So what's the point of this plastic lumber? Well, we just give back to the community. What we do is we'll put that, we'll add a little paint pigment to it, we'll literally brand it with our client's name, and we'll say made 100% out of Sony e-waste materials. And we will put this in their courtyard. A lot of our clients have these in a courtyard, and they are thrilled. The community sees it, the employees see it, their clients see it, they see it. It's something that's it's tangible. You can see, feel, and touch where your e-waste has gone. So this became a huge success. Not only do we get to give back to our clients, but I'm not going to lie, it's a fantastic calling card for us, and it is the right thing to do, and we figured it out. So that's the first step of upcycling. We figured out how to re-engineer mixed plastics, not just any plastic, mixed plastics. Anyone can re-engineer plexi. Anyone can re-engineer polycarbonate, but to do them with a mixed bag is incredibly challenging, and thanks to our wonderful team of PhDs and engineers, our laboratory, and all the support we've had, the final product, a wonderful plastic becomes to give back to the community. So that's step one. So now we're on a roll, and we go on to the next material. We start talking about glass. Glass is also a huge component of e-waste. Every screen, every computer, LCD, CRTs, laptops, cell phones, there's glass everywhere, and there's a lot of it. So besides the processing line you've seen, we also have what's called a glass granulator. What we do is we'll throw all the glass into this machine that pretty much spits it out as sand. It granulates it, it spits it out as sand. Very fine. The point of that is to densify it for real estate purposes. I mean, if we have bins and bins, we call them Gaylords in the industry. Gaylords are very large boxes that are filled with all sorts of tube TVs and LCDs. So what we do is we'll take the glass components of everything and granulate it, and usually it stops there. There's not much you can do with glass. People tend to landfill it, and there's nothing else you can do. There are some people that can get creative in using it with some sort of landscaping or decorative objects, but the mass amount of glass we have, unfortunately, that's not doing any justification to solving the problem here. So we started doing some investigating, and just like we kind of fuse our plastic together, we said, hey, you know what, let's see if we can literally fuse glass together. Let's see if we can just fuse it back and what we can make. And we tried making some decorative products, if you will, kind of a building product, you know, interior designing, if you will, just something we can do. But the first step was to fuse it, and guess what? We did. We fused it beautifully together. The problem was it was still very translucent. I mean, if you shine a light through it, you see right through it. And it kind of breaks apart under your finger, and it's a little jagged to the touch. It wasn't refined. It needed something else. So we started looking at other materials that we can use, and we actually started looking into waste streams outside of our industry. Through our laboratory testing, we found the closest particle, the closest element or material to glass is natural stone. Now, when I say natural stone, I'm speaking of your marble, your granite. And we kind of started diving into the industry and looking how much waste there is, and there's an obscene amount, and I'll tell you why. When there's quarries all over the world when it comes to natural stone, including Canada and the U.S. There's quarries everywhere, big in Italy, China. So to excavate these giant hunks of rock, it takes a lot of work. During this excavation process, it has to be large for a reason, because that giant hunk that they're excavating needs to be cut into blocks. Those blocks need to be cut into a particular size, because from those blocks, they need to slice it up into slabs. And those slabs need to be a particular size, because those slabs then need to be taken to the fabricator in order to fabricate your countertops, your cladding, your flooring, your tiling. So everything has to be what's called a usable size. So during this excavation process in the beginning, when they're carving this massive hunk of rock from the quarry in the mountain, there's a lot of rubble that falls to the side. This rubble could be the size of a pinhead, or it could be the size of your entire body. Needless to say, it's an unusable size. So what do? They landfill it. They dump it, sadly. And they're dumping huge amounts. So we decided to take some of these samples with us and do some elemental analysis and analytical analysis as well. And we realized it's very close to glass. So the next step was inevitable. We decided to fuse the natural stone with the glass from e-waste. And at the end of the day, it was a huge success. We were able to not only launch another sustainable business, a sister company, if you will. We actually have a live showroom here in Canada in a suburb called Woodbridge, or Vaughan rather, which is marble mecca here in Canada. It's where all marble comes. This is a live showroom. This is a true product. What you're looking at right now is the end product, an upcycled product of natural stone waste, because it's the rubble that fell to the side, as well as e-waste glass. It looks like marble. It is marble. It's as natural as it comes. Usually anything that's not from the quarry when it comes to marble or natural stone is considered what they call cultured marble or e-marble or e-stone, which stands for engineered stone. Now, the difference here is that engineered stone or cultured marble, you use a lot of chemical fillers. Our product, the upcycled product you see in front of you, is so pure that we cure it at 220 degrees Fahrenheit for 40 minutes. I mean, if we were in Arizona, you can put an order in for your countertop at 9 in the morning, I'd pop it out by noon and you'd be going home with a brand new countertop. We can also gauge the ratio of how much natural stone versus glass. What you're looking there at that slab in front of you, you're looking at about a 90% natural stone with a 10% e-waste glass. But the bottom line, at the end of it all, is not the fact that we've created jobs or launched a new sustainable business or are actually taking waste stream from a different industry altogether, including e-waste. The bottom line is the story to tell. We have a solution for e-waste glass. We've completely stopped landfilling glass, and this is our story. So not only are we doing it with mixed plastics, we're not incinerating it, we're not landfilling it, we're producing, extruding plastic lumber to give back to the community. And when it comes to e-waste glass, we are creating a beautiful new product. Remember, we're re-engineering what otherwise would have been waste materials into innovative new products, putting it back into the economy. And it's going to be a hell of a price as well. So this is the story we tell, a solution for mixed plastics, a solution for glass. Now, one thing that everyone needs to understand when it comes to glass is that there's two components to glass. What you're looking at your lower left-hand side is what's typically called a cathode ray tube TV, a CRT, if you will. These are the older monitors that you usually find back in my day when I was in university. But there's an abundance of them. These larger boxed-out screens, there's a bunch of them. They're coming in by the boatloads, and we're processing them. Here's what people don't understand, though. If you look at this screen on the lower left, what you're looking at to the left-hand side is the viewing area. Then you have a metal band. Behind that metal band, you see a dark gray glass kind of going into a funnel-like shape. That is chemically bound leaded glass. So the way CRTs are treated, and I'm going to be honest here, there's no solution for this anywhere in the world. The way this is treated is that we have what we call, any recycling processor should have this, it's called CRT dismantling. So we will cut that steel band, and then using a process, we will segregate. We don't slice because we'll create lead dust in the air. We have a very unique way to segregate the leaded glass from the unleaded glass. And for knowledge purposes, the way that's done is there's a metal rod, a metal band, if you will. We drop the CRT in a position, and there's like a metal belt that spins around it very quickly. The belt is about maybe, I'd say, a quarter of an inch wide. It tightens up against the glass, the line that segregates leaded from unleaded. It'll spin rapidly to create heat, and then it's we have nipples around this machine that spits out cold air at the same time. So as it's heating, we're spitting out cold air, and then it gives you a pop effect. It's almost like dumping an ice cube into a boiling cup of water. You get that pop, and we get that perfect pop, and that's how we're able to segregate the leaded glass and the unleaded glass. Now, the unleaded glass, we're not landfilling anymore. Remember, we are now granulating it, and we're fusing it with the granulated natural stone. And we're making wonderful decorative products and, again, avoiding landfill and all these other wonderful things that we're doing. Now, the leaded glass, just so you understand, in developed countries such as the United States of America and the Great White North, Canada, the extent of processing leaded glass right now is landfilling, sadly. But don't get too worried. What we do is we actually excavate pits within the landfill, and they'll line them. These landfills will be lined with, it's like a new age plastic. It's very, very incredible stuff. And then they dump the leaded glass within these liners to assure that the lead does not breach into our soil and or drinking water. I mean, that's the best we got, sadly. Unfortunately, underdeveloped countries don't even have this. They pretty much will dump the lead anywhere. And it's a sad state of affairs. So we figured we did it with plastics. We did it with glass. Why not do it with leaded glass? And we did. What we've done is, in typical ERS fashion, we granulated everything to a sand-like substance. We ran it through our spectroscopy X-ray machines to get a real clear understanding of what components are in here. And then what we did is, I want you to imagine a pile of sand, because that's how fine we granulate this leaded glass, into a pile of sand. And from that pile of sand, we're going to grab one granule, one little grain of sand. So that's what we're going to do. So what we did is, within that granule of sand, we encapsulated it in a polymer resin base. So we encapsulated it, we coated it, we covered it, we sealed it in a polymer resin base. And then we threw that little grain of sand that's been encapsulated into thorough testing, environmental testing such as UV testing, moisture testing, weathering, heat cold, heat thaw, and it passed with flying colors. At the end of the day, our preliminary testing has shown that our treated leaded glass shows minimal to zero traces of lead. Let me put this into perspective for you. The EPA allows maximum allowable levels of lead in our drinking water. We literally do have maximum allowable levels of lead in our tap water. They're 15 parts per million, or billion if I'm not mistaken, but nonetheless, they're detectable levels. Very minimal, but detectable levels, safe as per our government and environment. Our leaded glass is even safer than our drinking water. So what are we left with? Well, in essence, we're left with sand. What is sand good for? It makes a great aggregate for concrete, cement, concrete, except we call it green creep. So what we're doing now, not only are we treating mixed plastics and unleaded glass, but the leaded glass that comes from CRTs, which are still in abundance out there, we're granulating, encapsulating, and putting a portion of that sand, that leaded sand that's been encapsulated, no longer leaded, with natural sand to create a perfect aggregate to create concrete products. So we're not going to do structural, but what we are creating are giant potters and planters for the Parks and Recs Department, parking bumpers, pavers. But again, it's not the innovation. It's not this great other sister company that we've created that's going to be based out of Atlanta, Georgia, launching Q3 2014. It's the story behind it. We have a solution for leaded glass. Now, will we have the answer and be able to help the entire world? No. Is it a step in the right direction? Absolutely. Absolutely. So we are now upcycling mixed plastics, unleaded glass, and leaded glass, which is a great, great story to tell. So with the dissipation of CRTs, I'm sure we're all very familiar with LCDs. We haven't even begun to see the influx of LCDs and how much recycling we're going to have to do with these. Now, here's something interesting about LCD TVs. Within the viewing pane of glass, in between the panes of glass of the viewing area of an LCD TV, there's a very rare earth there, and it's called indium tinoxide, ITO. If this indium tin oxide, this rare earth, is compromised in any shape, way, or form, your LCD is rendered useless. So it's dumped. It's taken care of. It's brought to our facility. Now, we'd love to do that because we'll be able to recycle it. More than that, we can upcycle. We'll take the plastic casing around the LCD. We'll use that for our plastic lumber. We will take the glass and actually granulate that for our stone product. And then inside, there's a circuit board. Well, guess what? We're going to process that circuit board through our ESS, our electrostatic separation mechanism, and get some recovery out of that as well. So, but then we kind of scratched our head and said, why would we do that? Let's kind of look a little more into what's called ITO, indium tin oxide. If it's that rare, it's probably very expensive, it's probably worth something. So what we've done is we've figured out a way, there's got to be a way to recycle LCDs. Remember, if the indium tin oxide is compromised, the ITO, your LCD is rendered useless. So how could you recycle LCDs? Well, it's very, very difficult to excavate for ITO. It's very expensive. Why not recycle the ITO? Well, in this case, we're halfway there. What we've done within our laboratory is we were able to get that glass that has a coating of ITO on it and granulate it in classic ERS fashion. We turn everything to sand. Once it was granulated, we put it through acid. And the whole point of the acid was then to segregate the acid from the glass powder, which is called acid leaching. When we segregated the acid from the glass powder, we tested the glass, and there was no longer traces of ITO. This is where it gets exciting. We then said, well, there's only one other place that ITO could have gone. So we tested the acid, and hence, ITO, indium tin oxide. We've successfully leached indium tin oxide. The next step right now would be to extract it from the acid, solidify it, put it back on the market, ladies and gentlemen, or recycling LCDs, a technology that has not yet been found. Now, we can't take credit yet because we're only halfway there. We have leached it. The next step is to extract and solidify it, and that's what we're working on rigorously within our lab right now to try to do that. There are a couple of other companies that are fighting for this same technology, small companies. You may have heard of them. One's called LG. The other one's called Samsung. Unfortunately, they're very heavily funded, and we're doing our best to try to take the reins on this, but time will tell. But again, it's the exciting news, the news that we have to stop dumping and we stop stressing the earth with massive excavation, and we can simply just reuse this ITO. So that's basically our story right there, and that's what we do. We not only recycle, we upcycle and create, besides stimulating the economy with all these innovative new products, it's the story behind it environmentally is zero landfill, zero incineration, but upcycling into innovation. Thank you.
Jeff, did you want to show that demonstration?
Yes, I'm not sure. Let me just pull up my.
Right.
Are you guys? Are you able to view me?
No, your webcam was not on.
Okay, let me see if I can do this. Bear with me. So you still can't see me, correct?
No.
Just hit the on your webinar toolbar. Click on the webcam.
Yeah, I do. And unfortunately, it's grayed out, and it's saying webcam not detected. So let me see if I can go into my preferences and fix that. It says that they can't detect a webcam, unfortunately. I mean, it worked yesterday. Well, we can discuss it anyhow. What I have in front of me, the next innovation that ERS International is going to be doing is basically we're going to be dealing with fuel. We call it, ERS fuel. And what it is I have this little puck in front of me, and this little puck is here, and it's made out of basically yard trimmings, your grass, woody components, paper, including coffee cups, which a lot of people, ladies and gentlemen, it's important that you know that when it comes to coffee cups, it has a waxy film. Believe it or not, the majority of coffee cups, such as your Starbucks, are not recyclable. They really aren't because of the coating used to keep it cool in your hands. So we use that, plastic bags, to create this puck that's in the shape of a star, and we burn it, and we burn it clean. Now, the impressive thing about this ERS fuel, it's a green product. It's upcycled from waste, as I just mentioned. It burns blue, it burns clean, and it burns high. Anything that burns over 10,000 BTUs is considered industrial. Coal, industrial coal, if you will, burns at 10,800 BTUs. Our ERS fuel burns at 10,300. So you can cook with it, you can keep warm with it, you can run a locomotive with it. It's quite ingenious. Now, here's the best part about it, and I can't speak too intelligently about it because this is brand new. It was just put on my desk this week, so I'm still kind of doing my research, and I have to make sure I can market it accordingly. But what I do know is that it's waterproof. So if you look at any catastrophic act of God, whether it be flooding, whether it be a typhoon, whether it be a hurricane, whether it be a tsunami, when it comes to that destruction, water does a lot of damage. Well, guess what? Within that time, and it's going to take 10 to 14, 20 days to get your hydro back going, because that's the first thing to go in any catastrophic moment, you lose your hydro, we have fuel because it's waterproof. It'll still burn if it's submerged in water. So we're very excited about this, and again, I can't talk too intelligently, but I know that from the environmental testing that we've done, the other exciting part that this basically falls below any existing emission standard. So whatever is an allowable emission standard right now, we're way below that. So ERS fuel is only a green upcycled product, but it burns clean as well. And again, in any catastrophic area where there's water, we can pull this out of the water and light it and cook and keep warm. So that's the future of ERS right now. Our endeavors, our presidents and our company is heavily invested in research and development more than any other recycling company in the world. And I think it's been paying off because we're not only creating sustainable businesses and other sister companies along with it, but we are making an impactful difference into the environment. So that was the demonstration I was going to show. It's in my hand right now. Again, it's a puck that's a star shape, and it burns clean and it burns green.
Okay, thank you very much, Jeff. We'll open it up for questions now. We have a couple that people online have typed in, and then I'll take some from the audience. Do you want to tell me that, Beth, and I'll repeat it?
Yeah.
Or do you want to talk a little bit?
Do you have a process for separating the component metals from the powder grind and obtaining economic income from resale of those metals?
Yes, as mentioned before, the technology we call it's called electrostatic separation. So at the end of the day, when you're destroying all your e-waste and turning it into powder, because it's all about size reduction, that electrostatic separation will segregate metals from non-metals. and most of your metals would be, and we can also segregate. It gets a little more complex. We have what's called particle classification. So our machines are intellectual enough to distinguish, believe it or not, through density, precious metals versus non-precious metals, and that allows for a clean refinement. And what that's done is, yes, we can take that to the smelter for a revenue stream, which not only pays for the processing of e-waste, but we actually have a very transparent and very fruitful program for our clients. Now, this would only be fruitful if you're a very large global client, like one of our clients. It could be BlackBerry or Motorola or Sony. These large clients that are global have a lot of e-waste, and that's when it can actually become a positive revenue stream for them, which is great. I mean, it just motivates them to say, why would I want to dump this? Let me bring it to the right facility and get some revenue back that they can inject back into their business or back into their green programs or back into new technology. So to answer that, yes, we do have a technology. It's called electrostatic separation with particle classification.
Is there any other question?
So, if you have well-separated regular glass from leaded glass, could you recycle the unleaded glass in a variety of ways, not just making artificial stone?
Well, nobody else in the world seems to be doing what we're doing right now. This is groundbreaking stuff. We've experimented with other things, and it didn't quite work or hold. So hence, we did have to use the glass with another product. And again, through our testing, the only other material that has shared the same properties was the natural stone. And we went with it. I mean, we've tried several things, and it would fall apart, it would crumble. So when we found it, we felt like we found a winner because it densified so beautifully. Could you? Yes. Do we know other applications right now? No. No, right now we've stuck to what works, and it works beautifully. And again, it's doing two things. It's not only relieving the landfill, which was a success for us, but it's created a new sustainable sister company, which creates jobs and stimulates the economy as well. So down the road, we may pursue other products with glass, but to answer your question right now, not that I know of, the only thing that seemed to have worked from all our trials and tribulations was the addition of natural stone to the glass.
Okay, we have one more from online.
Sure. Do you have any facilities in the U.S.?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
Do you have any facilities in the U.S.?
We have several facilities all over the U.S. Actually, we're there's a facility in Chicago. It's one of our crown gems. It was actually launched last year, 2012. It's located in a suburb that you guys know as Buffalo Grove. Besides Chicago, we do have it in Bel Air, Ohio. We have it in Sioux City, Iowa, Santa Ana, California, Atlanta, Georgia. So we're pretty much all over the U.S. Our locations include Brazil and South America, mines in Germany, and two locations in China and one in Hong Kong. So we're pretty global. But I would encourage, if anybody is interested in a tour of our facility, we do encourage that. By all means, we can set something up with with Nancy or with whoever, and we can make you guys actually tour the facility and see it firsthand of what's going on with the e-waste and how it's processed and how it's organized and how it's taken care of.
Great. We have another question from online. Beth O'Lee.
Is your recycling business economically viable given that incoming devices are free, or do you need to charge for disposal services?
It's a great question. And here's the thing. To process these lines, to maintain these lines, you're talking about staffing, hydro. Not everything we get, just because it's free, not everything we get actually has recovery to it. There's a lot of, I mean, for lack of a better word, there's a lot of crap out there, which is just plastics. And we need to process that. And it costs, these machines are large, and it costs a lot of money to run them. So, no, it's not, just because it's free doesn't necessarily mean that we're making money all the time. That's why the only way for this to be viable for our clients and revenue sharing is we'd have to have a lot of commodity recovery available within these electronics. So there's ups and downs like any line of business. Sometimes we'll get a stream of just a lot of stuff that it costs. Like, for example, CRTs cost money to process. We have downstream vendors. You have to understand a lot of the stuff we do get, like fridges or air conditioners, they have certain coolants and materials in that we can't process. We're not allowed to, as per the government. We're not allowed to. So they have to go downstream to a particular partner who will process particular items. So there's reasoning behind all of it. But to answer the question, viable, but it's volatile like anything else. But, I mean, for the 10 years, we've been doing okay. But remember, within this time, people are catching on. I mean, you see it everywhere, and people are realizing what's going on. Competition is there as well, and competitors, so market share is divvied up between some of the big players. But we've been doing okay. We've been doing okay for the past 10 years, so I hope that answered the question.
Okay. I'll open it up to our audience here for questions. If people would like to come up and ask the question up here, or else I can repeat their question. So, anyone? Okay, we have another online question then.
What is your recovery rate for incoming metals, and what is your residual rate?
That's a good question. The recovery rate, I mean, can you specify, are we talking poundage?
I'm not sure. Maybe they can type in a specification.
Right, but why don't we go with poundage? Right,
well, here's what I can tell you. This is a question that probably goes more towards engineering, and all I know is that we can process up to 4 tons per hour of e-waste. So up to 4 tons per hour, we can actually fully process e-waste, which is very impressive. You're talking over 100 million pounds per year.
Any other questions from here? Beth, do you have any others? Well, we may have one more question from online.
Okay.
Seems to be a long one.
Well, so ERS in Canada has limited ability to innovate new uses for discarded metals materials.
I'm sorry, you're gonna have to repeat that one more time. I didn't hear you too much.
So EPR in Canada has limited ESRR's ability to innovate new uses for discarded materials.
Do you have any EPA restrictions on
EPR?
Okay. Does EPR limited any of your capability to recycle or make new products?
Well, when it comes to metals, I can tell you that the majority of metals, because there is residual value to metals, they are usually sent to downstream vendors, which typically goes to smelters. Right now, we haven't looked at doing anything with metals due to the fact that there's no need or demand for that, considering we're not landfilling. The smelters are dealing with it. Downstreams are dealing with it. They may be creating with it. As per any guidelines, again, I apologize. This may fall under a compliance issue, and we do have a global compliance director that probably could answer this. And I would be more than willing, before I let go, is to leave my email with you so people can redirect the questions, and I can actually redirect them to the important people so you can have an answer. But to my knowledge right now, if I understand the question correctly, are there restrictions? I'm not too sure, but when it comes to upcycling, there's no real need for it right now because we actually get paid for the metals, and it goes to the smelters. And once they melt it down, what they do with it could be upcycling, could be a lot of things. From what I understand, they do reuse the metals, and I'm very confident in that answer. So I don't know how elaborate or how deep these restrictions, if any, go. But again, let me just quickly throw my email out there to the listener who actually typed that question, because it is a very valid question. My email is jmendez, that's M as in Mary, E, N as in Nancy, D as in David, E as in Echo, Z as in Zulu, jmendez@ers-international.com. jmendez@ers-international.com.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Jeff, for speaking with us today and telling us about the new innovative methods you have for recycling and upcycling of electronics. We appreciate your time, and thank you to everyone here who's attended. Okay.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Nancy. Have a great day.
Okay, thanks. Bye.